Penguin Random House Audio presents Meaningful Work, A Quest to Do Great Business, Find Your Calling, and Feed Your Soul by Shawn Askinosie with Lawren Askinosie. This is the author, Shawn Askinosie. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes a bonus PDF, which can be viewed by opening the accompanying PDF file. This book is dedicated to my wife, Karen, and on behalf of my daughter, Lawren, to her husband, Scott, and her friend, Twabwike. Introduction. What the hell am I doing here, I ask myself again. I'm neither Catholic nor a wilderness guy, by any stretch of the imagination. I parked and turned around to look in my back seat. I'd packed all of the requisite stuff, about 15 books to keep me company, because I'd never really been alone before. Music, a candle, snacks. Of course, I brought my dog-eared and underlined Tuesdays with Maury, the Bible, and my favorite Jimmy Carter book, Sources of Strength. Assumption Abbey is a Trappist monastery that was established in 1950 by its mother house, the New Melleray Abbey in Iowa. A generous donor inspired by Thomas Merton's seven-story mountain deeded 3,000 acres in Missouri, surrounded by national forest land, to the monks. Still in the driver's seat, as though I was tethered, I reminded myself I was here for a retreat, and also for a special reason. Arms full of the aforementioned stuff, I found my way to the guest house. An Irish woman, Bridget, managed it in those days, and she greeted me warmly. I think she sensed my uneasiness. There were just 9 rooms in the guest house, she told me. As she led me down a corridor, she explained that, per my request, she had done her best to make sure that my room was the one in which my father had spent the last night of his life. Standing at the room's threshold, peering into the sparsely furnished interior, I felt a looming sense of dread, coupled with a certainty that this weekend retreat at Assumption Abbey was exactly what I needed to be doing. More than 25 years ago, I wore a suit and tie and stood by my mother's side next to my father's open casket at his visitation. I'd been to funerals before, but I'd never stood next to a dead body for 4 hours. As everyone came through the line to offer their condolences and pearls of wisdom about how I needed to be the man of the family, I remembered robotically repeating, "I just don't know where I would be without my faith." I was 14. During a break in the receiving line, Father Salmon approached me. He was an Episcopal priest at our family's church and my dad's good friend. I still remember his enveloping hugs. "Shawn, I want to tell you a story about what happened a few days ago at Assumption Abbey when I was with your dad on our men's retreat there." Preoccupied with feigning stoicism, I wasn't interested in listening, but I was a captive audience. "It was the last night that we were there, and your father came across the hall and knocked on my door around 10 p.m. He said, 'Don, I was in my room praying. I wasn't dreaming. I was just visited by 3 angels. They told me I was going to die, that I was going to be okay, and that my family would be protected.' He meant to comfort me, but instead I felt annoyed. Plain and simple, I wanted my dad back. And the story of angels wasn't cutting it for me. Person after person would shake my hand and tell me what a great man my dad was. They were right. My dad was a lawyer who fought for civil and criminal justice. I would often tag along with him to the court and watch his trials. Among his many acts of community service, he started legal aid in our town for people who couldn't afford an attorney. He took me with him to the courthouse on Thursday nights, and people would be lining a long hallway waiting on wooden benches to meet with him. Even though he was out of the Marine Corps by then, he always stayed in good shape and taught boxing until he got sick. I remember him constantly doing one-handed push-ups. An extremely attentive father, he was the one who would come into my room when nightmares struck. I remember the comforting glow of the dial on his Accutron astronaut watch as he lay in bed with me while I tried to fall asleep. When I was 12, he was diagnosed with lung cancer. He had not smoked since the military. He went to the Mayo Clinic for surgery, and when he came home, he and my mom said, They got it all. They didn't. Our family's faith was supposed to help us cope. I grew up Episcopalian, apparently an appealing denomination for a converted Jew, my dad, and former Southern Baptist, my mom. When my dad became sick, we switched to a new church in town, St. James Episcopal, considered the charismatic church, meaning the parishioners spoke in tongues, were filled with the Holy Spirit, and spoke prophetically in services. It kind of freaked me out. Convinced God would heal my dad if my family had the right kind of faith, the church prayer group would frequent our house for impromptu meetings, where they laid hands on him. The prayer leader, an insurance salesman, would raise his voice at God and Satan during long, stressful sessions. Sometimes they'd stay for hours, doing things I didn't understand but definitely did not find comforting. He and the others admonished me, "Don't talk to your dad about death. It's a sign of weakness, and Jesus won't heal him if you have such doubt." So we didn't discuss it. My dad would try to talk to me, but I would say, "Dad, we can't talk about it or you won't be healed." There were more surgeries, and though they supposedly got it all each time, he kept getting sicker. His nausea was unrelenting, as was his excruciating pain, for which he needed multiple shots of Demerol throughout the day and night. We didn't have hospice care back then, and my mom just couldn't bring herself to stick him with a needle. So the doctor taught me how to give my dad injections. I wanted to help relieve my hero's pain more than anything, and this was my chance. By 13, I was giving my dad several shots a day, often running out of healthy tissue on his hips. The smell of rubbing alcohol always brings these memories flooding back. Cancer can be a roller coaster. Some days he felt great, and others terrible. The week before he died, my dad tried a case in court. A few days later, he made the trip to Assumption Abbey with his friends from church. The day he returned from the Abbey, Mother's Day 1975, he lay in bed most of the afternoon and evening, until about 10:30 p.m., when he called my mother upstairs. I went up to their room, and he was sitting up on the side of the bed. He seemed confused and said, "I've always tried to help people." He lay back down and reached for a glass of water, and I asked him the question that had become my refrain over the past 2 years. "How are you feeling, Dad?" His reply was the same as always, "I'm feeling fine, son," even though he wasn't. They were the last words he spoke, to me or anyone. On his back, head on the pillow, he looked up and his eyes seemed to freeze in place. Time stopped and I screamed for God, "Please help me, please heal him, please don't let him die," over and over. I was desperate. My mom was crying hysterically and she went to close my little brother's bedroom door. I was afraid to touch him. He was dead, and there was nothing I could do. I have never in my life felt as overwhelmed by shock and sorrow as I did in that moment, or as helpless. Within an hour, the whole prayer group was at our house. Two ladies from the group asked me to come upstairs to my parents' bedroom, where my father's body still lay. We knelt down next to the bed, and they tried to raise him from the dead back to life. After several minutes of this, they told me that my dad did not want to come back, that they saw the blood come back to his lips, but that he was happier now. My father's death was and remains my greatest sorrow. During his military burial, two buglers played echo taps, one next to the casket and one unseen on the other side of National Cemetery. If I hear that melody today, I am right back there in the cemetery, as if it was just 2 minutes ago. For the couple of years after his death, I waited to fit into his clothes, which still hung in the closet. I wanted to be able to wear his shoes. I wanted to keep his car, but my mom sold it. Though it was the right thing for her to do, I was pretty angry when she did it. We did not really talk much about my dad after he died. As a kid, I was not equipped to grieve thoroughly. Instead, I told God I was going to prove that I didn't need him and that I could accomplish all of my goals without his help. 2 years after my father died, when I was 16, I began working after school every day for a local lawyer. and I became Missouri Boys State Governor. After that, I qualified for the National Speech and Debate Tournament. While still in high school, I became a congressional page in the U.S. House of Representatives. After my freshman year in college, I volunteered for the American Embassy in Thailand during the Vietnam refugee crisis. I subsequently spent a year of college in Japan. I maintained this pace into adulthood, keeping incredibly, sometimes maniacally, busy, usually with things that truly engaged me and that I felt good about doing. Eventually, I became a successful criminal defense lawyer, just like my dad.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.